You have to pay for what you get. It's not a gift. I don't have a gift. I'm the gift to my people, but it's costing me. It's not costing them.
What is it costing you?
It has cost me my health years ago. I had a stroke, bad marriage, being accused of a child out of wedlock that was 0.000, church people trying to betray. Maybe one or two in here that may have heard, because rumors go out, BM, for you do. And wherever your rumor spreads, so will you. So it's all good with me. Once we focus on what we're here for, I was telling them in that wonderful limousine that y'all picked us up in.
Thank you.
You know, I said to them that I used to have a problem giving everyone what God gave me and then not hearing from him. But then the Lord told me one night, it was so plain, because we have prophets out here, prophetess. It's a fact. The Bible says, and I shall pour out of my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy. I didn't say they would preach. See, the difference in preaching and prophesying, you got to preach from here. But does God still speak when the book is closed? See, that's his continuation of a sermon. Mm-hmm. But the Lord told me, I am a pitcher of water. Pitchers of water don't get thirsty. We quench everybody else's thirst. After he pours us out, it's our job to be clean and put on the shelf for the next thirsty group of people. And once you accept what your calling is, you are happy in everything that you do.
Wow.
Absolutely.
People call you a praiseologist. Why?
Because I believe, because I believe, even as I peruse all of these beautiful people, that when we put our ministry before our creativity, we are out of order. I like causing trouble. I'm very disturbed by preachers who can preach who won't worship.
I'm very disturbed
by folk who will play music and think that's their ministry but not get off and dance when it hits everyone else. I used to be an ex-drug dealer in Brownsville, Brooklyn, not ashamed to say it, but I get very disturbed when I see people only get excited when it's their time on the show. Like crack. So when that mic ain't in their hand, they're crossing legs looking deep. But once they touch it, everybody get with me when I think of the goodness. That really does me a disservice. Because the Bible says that we are created to praise. We are called to preach. Chosen to lead. So the most important thing to me, which is debatable by some who will see the show, and those who may even sit among us, is when we go to heaven, won't be no more preaching. Won't be no more laying hands on the sick. But if you ain't a praiser, you ain't going. Yeah. So when I say put your mouth on it, I fully believe that what your pocket can't buy, your praise can, and what your money can't buy, your message can. I've got my first car, my first Mercedes. That's what I call a car. The other ones were stepping in, standing in the gap. See, what I have a problem with, and that's why I don't come on television much, is I don't like when people are real sanctified and act like there's no life after church. I wore all black because I planned on eulogizing fake preachers. See, people are looking, but that's what the Lord told me when I came. He said, you are to wear all black and let them know that the new parent is called transparent. We cannot hide from the people behind the text. Jesus became the word, then he put it in the book. You got to preach you.
Wow.
You. And then when people know you keep it real, they can hear what else you have to say in the name of the Lord. Wow. But if you use the Lord's name, then we find out you fake. It's hard to hear anybody talk about God anymore.
That's good.
And that's my issue with all of this.
You know, I've heard you preach a sermon where you said, I dated a sinner.
I did.
Yeah. You kept it real.
I can't do it anymore, but...
No.
I did.
Yeah.
But the very interesting twist, because I know why you're leading me down here, because you're a genius.
Not at all. You give me way too much credit.
And y'all know she is. She's a genius.
Not at all.
But I have never dated a sinner. The Lord said, come out from amongst them and be ye separate, not separated. So sinners are not bad people. They're just people who have not yet met the Lord. It's the fake saint that's bad. Who keeps the sinner from seeing God. So I decided to go out and try to live a normal life because I was a prophet and I met a young lady who didn't know what I did for a living. She didn't know about God, she just met me. I tried to keep it on the DL And one day we got closer and closer. It was the best girlfriend I ever had. And one day I decided, now that we're close, I want her to see what I do. She said, what you do? I said, we're going to come to one of my revivals, and I just want you to sit there and tell me what you think about my preaching. Well, when I got up there and I and the Holy Ghost did what we did, we got in the car and I went to get my kiss, and she said, I'm not touching them holy lips. I'm sorry, I cannot do it. And I begged her, this was the truth, to go further, and she said to me, a sinner, she says, I will never come between what I just saw and who I am. He will not kill me, which means sinners respect the power of God more than we do ourselves.
You just gonna come hard tonight? Is that what we're doing?
No. This might be my one and only shot. I'm with Lexi.
Whatever. Whatever. You know, I wanted to give you the opportunity. Is the Lord saying anything to you for anyone in the room? How does your gifting work? Do you have to, you know, go through a whole praise service and conjure up the Holy Ghost? Or do you walk with it, you know, or do you walk with it on a daily moment by moment basis where he just constantly talks to you? How does that work?
That's a very great question, and I refuse to make it seem like I'm the twin of Jesus Christ.
Sure.
I don't walk with it 24 hours a day. It walks with me 24 hours a day, but I don't walk with it 24 hours a day. And yes, the truth is, in most of my services, it's not the service, it's when I worship that it works, wow, not the people or the music. It's when I do my pre-worship before I come to churches who want us to perform. It's my daily worship that leads me to give daily bread. Now, I can peruse this audience. I don't see anything. But what I hear God say is that the people that are here are blessed, but that he's about to make them take advantage of the famine, because the famine was to bring the prices down to the place of their pockets. That anyone who never saved money can't afford nothing now, even though the price has dropped. And he tells me about education. So when I'm standing here thinking about education, he tells me that there's a young lady here who he wants to give $11,298 to make her go back and attend school and get the degree she needs to go higher. And that's the girl on the end with silver shoes and the black dress on with her lace crossed like this. So it doesn't matter. That's why she's looking, because he's speaking that clear. That's what he does. He has no problem addressing who he's made. He has a problem with folk he's made taking what he addresses. Because it's not coming to you. He speaks it, and you must go after it. Wow. So if you want that $11,298, you go back online, you apply, you reestablish yourself, and don't make excuses. And then you never, whoever you are in the third row, worry about whether he loved me, he left me, I was gone, but he promised to marry me. That means nothing in the 21st century.
Do you want to be married?
I think marriage is wonderful. I don't think that it's a necessity, it's an accessory.
I've never asked you that. I asked you, did you want to be married?
And that means... And that means I don't believe that God will allow anyone such as myself or anyone that's highly anointed in this audience to have a sex drive, to have an anointing, and not need to be married. So my answer is yes. But the thing I was saying is not to be a necessity. When a woman knows class, she puts on a black eloquent dress. She does not wear five pieces of jewelry. She just needs a string of pearls. And what every man needs is a string of pearls. We are so busy looking at diamonds, and I'll take a dime. She's a dime. She's fine. She could sing, pastor's wife. But they don't have that person that when you're down, who can minister to you and say, get your little self back up and be focused. So, yes, if she exists, and I believe she does, I'll wear my string of pearls. Absolutely.
You all right?
Absolutely.
Lastly, I want to say, you know, you've been talked about. You've been through a lot. You've been, again, through the loss that you've went through. And you've been, like you said earlier, you know, you've been talked about. You've been through a lot. What has kept you preaching? What has kept you through it all, through everything? What has kept you saying, you know what, I'm going to do the work of the Lord. I don't care. Because you a hard dude.
You called me the YouTube preacher. But what kept me is I never saw or met anyone that when I know I did wrong, still spoke to me like I had value but him. I know what I did. I wasn't doing it to her, to them, to the church. My animosity was against God, all that I knew about him. I'm a fifth generation pastor.